United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next item on our agenda is the interest, items of interest, recognition, and inquiry. Board of Education members, anybody have anything?
Just congratulate St. Clair Little League for the 13-year-olds won the state championship, and they're playing in the regional now, and they've got a couple wins in regionals, so they're trying to play for a chance at the World Series in California. So, and then the 9 and 10-year-olds were hosting, St. Clair Little League's hosting the state tournament, and St. Clair won again today, so they're in the semifinals tomorrow.
Wow.
Awesome.
Dr. Skoll?
Yes, Marine City High School Business Essential students will be making a trip during the 15-16 school year to Disney World. It is part of Disney's program for high school business students to understand how operations such as Disney run, from all aspects of marketing to infrastructure to everything else. And so we wanted tonight to thank the Rene Tennyson Foundation, who made a generous donation on the business students' behalf in order to help them get there. So thank you. Wow.
All right. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. We're going to start the annual organizational items, and it'll be a series of motions to preset all of our depositories and so forth that we use to operate our school district. Appointment of Executive Secretary. Recommended action: the Board of Education approves Superintendent Dr. Stephen Skolka as Executive Secretary to the Board and direct that he post proper notice of all meetings as given. Motion needed?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Kennebauer?
Support.
Support by Mrs. Murphy? Comments or questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. So carried. Appointment of legal counsel. Per administration recommendation, the Board of Education approves Turn Law Firm as legal counsel. Motion needed?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Kennebauer.
Support.
Support by Mr. Richley. Comments or questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Designation of newspaper for public notices. Per administration recommendation, the Board of Education designate the Times Herald and the Voice for public notices. Motion needed?
So moved.
Mr. Kennebauer?
Support.
Support, Mr. Richley. Comments or questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Authorization for investment of surplus funds. The administration is recommending that the board authorize the executive director for finance as designated agent of the treasurer to invest surplus funds of the district in accordance with Act 87 of the Public Acts of 1979, following generally accepted business practices and in the best interests of the district.
So moved.
Mr. Kennebauer?
Support.
Support by Mrs.
I'll give it to Mrs. Murphy.
Mrs. Frank. Comments or questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, same sign. Waiver of tax collection interest. Administration is recommending that for the 2015-16 fiscal year, the board shall not require payment of interest earned on taxes collected on behalf of the school district by the various municipality units of the district, provided such taxes collected are remitted at the following schedule: Detroit Edison property taxes remitted upon receipt, all other property taxes remitted biweekly. Motion needed?
So moved.
Mr. Kennebauer?
Support.
Mrs. Bebuck? All those in comments or questions?
I've got a question. Mm-hmm. Why do we waive the interest?
And that's past practice. I say hesitantly because I'm not sure. Other than that has been the practice of the district to do so. Without Ms. Weglar's here tonight, It would be something I'd have to get back with you on.
I know the Detroit Edison property taxes.
It sounds contradictory.
Upon once they collect, they automatically fund them to us. So there really isn't any time frame in there. We'd have to find out on the municipalities.
This is before my time, but I think part of it was when they changed from winter collection to summer collection. I think part of the deal was to make it less controversial was they were like, well, we'll waive the interest just to allow people that aren't able to pay.
I don't think it's being waived. I think it's just this schedule of the payment. That's the way I read this.
Can we table that till we understand it?
Yeah, not a bad idea.
Okay. Need a motion to table the waiver of tax collection interest?
I'll make a motion to table it.
Support.
Mr. Richley, Mrs. Frank, comments or questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. So tabled. Designation of dispositories for school. Recommended action. Administration is recommending that the following institutions be designated as official depositories for the district and that the individuals holding the positions named be authorized as signatories on each account listed. Official depositories are Charter One, Chase, Comerica, Fifth Third Bank, Talmer Bank and Trust, Flagstar Bank, Merrill Lynch, Michigan Liquid Asset Fund, Morgan Stanley Smith Barney, North Star Bank, Bank of America, Huntington Bank. Sinking fund are checking accounts. Authorized signatories are Treasurer and President, Building and Site, Treasurer and President, Payroll Account, Treasurer and President, General Fund Account, Treasurer and President, Debt Retirement Account, Treasurer and President, Cafeteria Account, Executive Director or Superintendent, Internal Account, Executive Director or Superintendent, Marine City High School Internal Account, Principal, Executive Director or Superintendent, Marine City Middle School Internal Account, Principal, Executive Director or Superintendent, St. Clair High School Internal Account, Principal, Executive Director or Superintendent, St. Clair Middle School Internal Account, Principal, Executive Director or Superintendent. Motion needed?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Kinnickbauer.
Support.
Support by Mrs. Murphy. Comments or questions?
I just have one question.
Yes.
A while ago, I think it was a couple years back, we had an issue with the signers. Is everything is updated, I assume?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
Bank of America, do we still deal with them? Because Bank of America, I know on the River Road is now Huntington Bank. I mean, I know it's probably not an issue, but I was just wondering.
I think just in order to make sure that we have all bases covered, we list them both.
You list, okay.
Yep.
All right.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Adoption of regular monthly meeting schedule. Per administration, the Board of Education adopt the regular meeting schedule as shown on page 5. Motion needed?
So moved.
Mr. Kinnickbauer?
Support.
Support by Mrs. Bebuck. Comments or questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Opposed, same sign. So carried. Next item on our agenda is the consent agenda. Approval of minutes, regular Board of Education meeting, June 22nd, 2015. Approval of payment of bills, financial statement, schedule of investments. Recall of laid off teacher, approval of new teachers. Motion is needed.
So moved.
Mr. Kinnickbauer?
Support.
Support by Mrs. Bebuck. Comments or questions? Seeing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Opposed, Mr. Richley. Recognition of persons wishing to address the board. I have one card, Mr. Eric Longuski.
President Beaver, members of the board, Dr. Skelka. My name's Eric Lundeski. I'm the ECEA president. And I suppose I'm a few minutes late, a dollar late, or a day late and a dollar short. We kind of apply here. But I would not be comfortable if I did not voice my opinion to the appointment of the Troon Law Firm as the district's legal counsel. I've had one dealing with the representative, and it was easily the most uncomfortable, disastrous professional meeting I've ever had in 25 years. It was, the effect of that meeting lingered for weeks and weeks. I won't go into much detail beyond that, but my faith in that firm is shattered. And I don't know what you think of me. We all know each other pretty well over the years. But when the man looks at me across the room and says in his most pitiful voice, "You disgust me," meaning me, and how I was conducting myself and my thoughts and my beliefs, I took that very personal, among many things that one of the representatives said at our meeting. So if we do take Troon Law Firm as our representative counsel, I would hope we keep them on an incredibly short leash, and that we never, ever allow Eric Delaporte to ever work in our district again. His conduct was reprehensible, and the damage he caused will linger for years. So that's all I have to say. And again, didn't realize it was coming up at this point. I would have spoken to you further or earlier about this, but we can probably get along with these people, but we cannot get along. At least I know I cannot get along ever with that man. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Item six, reports. Superintendent report.
Yes, I'd like to start with Eddie start and end times. We know that we overflow students between our elementary schools based on contract class size language, and when, for example, we reach the max in one grade level at a building, if there are available seats in another nearby building, we will overflow a student rather than creating another section and then adding a teacher and adding the cost. So it's really the efficient, we do so for the efficient use of staff and resources. Right now, between Eddie and Gearing going back and forth, depending on the grade levels, we have 34 students that are overflowed from what would be their resident elementary school to the other school, depending on the grade. And with the same start and end times, what has happened over the last several years is that students were dismissed prior to the end of the day to ride transfer buses because, for example, if I'm a student in the Gearing attendance zone and I was attending Eddy via overflow, I would get out early, I'd get a transfer bus back to Gearing in order to get on the Gearing bus that took all the kids back to that neighborhood. The challenge for us, and it has been a challenge over several years, and it just became such that I said to our principals, director of transportation, and at the time, Mrs. Tenniswood, and now Mrs. Woolman, I said, I want to eliminate the early release of those students. I don't want them to be missing class time anymore to get back for a transfer bus. And so the solution, it seems easy, but we know that when we make one decision, it ripples out into many other aspects of the organization. But we think we have it in terms of staggering the Eddy and Gearing start and end times. So previously, Eddy was at 8:40 like all the rest of the elementaries and St. Clair Middle. We've done all of the bus routes. We've taken a look at the kids, where they live, how we can do this. And if we start Eddy at 20 minutes earlier, then they would end 20 minutes earlier. They would get on that transfer bus back to Gearing or the Gearing kids over to Eddy in time because they've done their work, and we can get the kids home without missing their buses or missing instructional time. So in making this change, we wanted to let you know that tonight, and as well as we wanted to make sure that you knew that we do have a camp communication plan in place to let the parents of these students, especially all Eddy students and especially the overflow students, know that at the end of this month we will make what is the robocall that goes to all homes. It'll be on the district webpage. It'll be, of course, on the sign in the district newsletter, welcome back news. Every single opportunity we have between now and the start of the school year, we will make sure that we are communicating the fact that we'll be staggering and that Eddie will start 20 minutes earlier this year. We communicated with the ECEA as well, because we know this is a change in their teacher times as well. But as was pointed out, if we can, if the teachers get a little earlier end to their day, they'll be supportive of that as well. And they don't want to have their kids missing the end of the day every single day either. They want the instructional time. So we feel good about this, and we will be working to communicate it, to put it in place. And tonight was our first night of making sure we start that communication. The stadium turf replacement project, I am happy to report to you, not just ahead of, not just completed, but completed ahead of schedule and under budget. And if you will bear with me, I'd like to show you the work from start to finish in 3 minutes and 42 seconds. Thank you. I'd like to thank Mr. Cottrell for those aerial pictures, which we greatly appreciate, as well as Craig Headley for doing the work to not only do the time lapse, but to edit the time lapse for us tonight. It was we really appreciate that. So what about that old turf? A lot of folks have talked to us about the old turf, and we are going to run a fundraiser. And our fundraiser, we're debuting tonight, and we will also get out in multiple ways, including the district newsletter. One foot by one foot square of the old turf, $10, suitable for framing, and I will speak about that very shortly. And a 2-foot by 3-foot rectangle for welcome mat size will be available, and vouchers will be available at Mariner Days and Saint Days. They'll also be available here in the central office starting August 24th. You might ask, why vouchers? The crumb rubber, the black stuff that you see coming up, we're not able to get that out of the previous turf in a very efficient manner. So you really don't want to be sitting in a football game with a piece of this on your lap for 2 hours, or you want to handle it as little as possible. So if you were to pick up a voucher here at Saints Day, we don't want to deliver a pallet full of this stuff to sit in the newly cleaned Marine City High School for the school year, or St. Clair High School. So again, if you are interested and you pick up a voucher, you can pick them up on the second or third here out at the maintenance garage. We suggest that maybe you shake it out the best you can, or you throw it in the back of a pickup, or have something available to do that. Suitable for framing. I have gone down and spoken with Mark at Picture This, the frame store downtown on Water Street in Marine City. And he has partnered with us, and he will be selling kits, shadow box kits that I will pass down to you in both black and orange and red and blue. So that if you are interested, you can put together your piece of turf with a picture and a little plate indicating what it is. These kits would be available to you. You would assemble the kit with your piece of the turf, and again, to handle it as least as possible, and then to use it, make sure you get the crumb rubber out. But we think it's a pretty neat idea, and I truly appreciate Mark and Picture This for partnering with us. We'll have that stuff available as well. You can keep it down there. We'll have the St. Clair one up at Saints Day, the Marine City one down at Mariner's Day for folks to see. And if they're interested, the welcome mat size, again, for folks who really want to beat the crumb rubber out of it and use it as a welcome mat, awesome, go for it, you know. The other piece to this, and one of the reasons why we're going for vouchers again, is it's difficult to cut as well. It's very labor intensive. So we were trying to get a number or a read as to how many we will need to have ready. My guess is that if this goes well, we'll probably also have one more round at the St. Clair Marine City football game, sell vouchers that night as well. Yeah. One more round. We won't have pieces there. We'll have another pickup date at that point in time. But we're going to give folks that opportunity. And again, I think Mark's just done an excellent job with the shadow boxes and the ideas. So we'll let you know how it goes.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
So 1988, I think, is the year that the stadium opened, but not the year that they had turf.
So we will correct that. We're trying to get samples ready.
Grass,
you played on grass. We were trying to get samples ready for tonight, so we'll make sure it's accurate.
For your time frame, it was 1 year before U of M put in their similar turf.
And Craig, you're here tonight. Where's Craig?
No, he's not here.
I'm not Craig. Kirk. Excuse me. Kirk, could you just briefly share with the board what you walked the final project, because you went over the punch list. You were with the president of AstroTurf, who flew up here specifically to see the install. Why did he do that?
He came up here from Tennessee, and he commented that he believed that we were going to have one of, if not the premier football turf in the state because of that Brock pad and all of the graphics design on there. So he came up from Tennessee to do the walkthrough, mm-hmm. and create the punch list with me and Bruce from Foresight Design.
It was kind of neat for him to come up, so we were pretty excited. So, thank you. Yep. Mm-hmm. Game night and turf pickup. Sponsorship update, just very quickly. It is slow and steady, but we keep after it. Right now, we have 8 commitments, and we're moving forward. As folks come back, as the administrators come back to work too, we continue to work at it, and so we will continue to make progress there as we again look to raise revenue for the district and give our partners opportunities to have significantly more exposure at events than they've ever had in the past. So, ECEC sale update, spoke with Mr. Wolfson a couple of times in last week and then again today. You may have seen in the last month in the paper, in the Times Herald, that he has agreed to purchase a property in Port Huron as well. That in no means has diminished his interest in our property. It's not one or the other. His comment to me was, if I'm going to do one project, I might as well do two. He's looking to get a foothold, I believe, in the St. Clair County area. So I want to dispel any thought that maybe that means that something was up with our project. He is currently working very closely with David Hayes, who is part of the St. Clair County Economic Development Authority. They have multiple meetings set up both in Lansing with state officials and our own local legislators in order to, they're looking to change some zoning rules and some DDA boundaries and things to maybe free up some more money for this project. So everything continues apace, and we'll keep you abreast of the situation as things develop. Okay.
Next item on our agenda is information discussion items, board policy and EOLA updates. Dr. Scopo?
Yep. I gave you quite an extensive packet of NEOLA updates. NEOLA, again, is the service that keeps track of all of the changes in state and federal law and regulations so that your board policies are consistent and comply with them. I did, this time around, I did a one-page kind of summary for everyone to understand what those changes were about. They are on your agenda tonight. For any discussion, questions, or if you need additional information for me to go find, they will be an action item next month.
Board policy 4112.
This was board and staff communications that was requested by Trustee Richley.
Yep, thank you. Did everybody read the packet that I submitted at the last meeting? Mm-hmm. Okay. The thing that I wanted to go over, I obviously submitted a letter and a bunch of informational items, which, of course, we swear to uphold the Constitution of both the state and country. And so I think that part of what, and it's both 3112 and 4112. I apologize. I didn't realize that it's board staff communications in I think the 4,000s is that personnel.
3,000s are certificated employees, and 4,000 are non-certificated employees.
Okay. And so the changes that I wanted to see made to the board, what I'm proposing is the addition of this, I guess you can say, quotation, the board recognizes and it encourages the rights of free speech as protected by the First Amendment of the United States Constitution and Article 1, Section 5 of the State Constitution, and supports the free flow of information from students, staff, parents, and the entire community. And then keeping this part of the policy that says the Board of Education desires to maintain open channels of communication between itself and the staff, understanding the importance of the chain of command, the basic line of communication is suggested to be through but not limited to the superintendent. That would be the, that last part is the part that, there was parts that were eliminated through that, but I submitted this to everybody at the last meeting. But the thing that I think, it's a similar thing that happened in Port Huron, and I think there was an article that I also put in this as well, from when they decided to change their policy. And so basically, I think that it's something that we should consider doing. And obviously, it's not an issue right now, but eventually, it could potentially be an issue. I mean, I don't think that that's something that we have to worry about with Dr. Skalka or any current board members, but policies are put in place for future things that could potentially happen. And so I think it's something just to consider that. For instance, there was a lawsuit at SC4 over the same issue. So, and they settled out of court because they knew they were going to lose. And they took that policy out of their policy books. So are there any questions or concerns? Or
just one of the things that I know since I think even you've been on the board, that we now have a board email site that goes strictly just to the seven of us. It doesn't go to Dr. Skalka or anything. And that, I think that's been a great asset for us as a board and the public, knowing that they can send a comment to us at any time. As soon as it hits the website here, the email, it goes out to all seven of us.
Right.
And then at times, I'm sure we've all forwarded it to Dr. Skalka, and we may have all done the same seven in one of an hour.
Right.
But something that we read that felt that it needed his direct attention, and we would move it forward. And I think that has worked really well.
Right. Oh, I agree. Okay. But I think that this policy contradicts that. Like, do you mind if I read the current policy? Or you all have read it, haven't you?
We've read it.
Okay. So, but I mean, that's, I think it contradicts the parts that say that specifically, it says all communications, the word all communications from staff members to the board or its committees shall be submitted through the superintendent. And then it says, this is the second sentence in that section A, this procedure is not intended to deny any staff member the right to appeal to the board on important matters through established procedures. But that's contradicting when it says all communication from staff should go through the superintendent, in my opinion, because technically every time that we get an email from a staff member through that email, that would be a violation of that policy, which is unconstitutional. But in my opinion.
So if if between tonight and next board meeting, if I were to take Trustees Richley's suggestions and send to you a draft revision, would you be okay with that? So that you have something to vote on next month.
Okay, sure.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Yep. You can keep my copy.
Last information item is facility planning. Dr. Skalka.
Yes, this will take the lion's share of the meeting. We have a good deal of information to present to you, but that's understandable as this is the a significant issue before you. I truly appreciate the work that the board has put in over the last month since the June board meeting when it received the facilities report from Barton Mallow. You have taken it seriously. You've researched. You've done a lot of work. You've asked a lot of great questions. We've provided that feedback to them as well as to our Director of Operations, Kirk Grzelka, and Director of Technology, Craig Headley, because as you have looked through the report and as you've discussed things, some things that have bubbled to the surface in terms of priorities has been building infrastructure, building technology, safety and security, and then programming. So tonight, I want to turn it over to those three. Craig remotely, as he is out of the state with his son, but we'll start with Kirk, who has some information to provide to you regarding building infrastructure that piggybacks on the comments that Mrs. Murphy made last month about how valuable it was to tour the facilities. We want to give you a little pseudo tour tonight with a lot of pictures, so if we could go ahead. Yep.
Thank you.
Okay, as I go through the facilities presentation, feel free to stop me and ask any questions that you might have. Well, the first item is pool heater that needs replacement. This heater is no longer capable of heating the pool when the main school boilers are shut down. During the warmer months, we cannot run the main school boilers without overheating the classrooms themselves, and then this causes the pool water to be underheated during the warmer months.
Which pool heater is this?
This is Marine City. This is a slide on some of our aging infrastructure that sometimes fails. This repair was completed, but the entire pipe actually needs to be replaced in the next few years to prevent possible loss of school time if it were to fail at the wrong time of the year.
As I learned, we actually own and are responsible for maintaining the pipes from the building to the water main, which is an extensive distance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes hundreds of feet, right. Usually on our property all the way out to the road where the main valve and this is where we own.
And these are at all the buildings?
We have that type of utility that we own at all the buildings. This particular failure was at Pine River.
Okay.
What was, when that was replaced before, do you have off the top of your head, probably not, I don't have it off the top of my head, but the cost of that repair?
This wasn't replaced, it was repaired with that coupling that you can see the guys clamping onto the pipe right now. So the pipe is still existing, it just has a repair clamp over the leak. That repair, if I recall correctly, was around $5,000.
And it was cheap. I remember the people that came out,
we got a discount because I worked with the East China Township Water Department, and myself and our staff worked together to make that repair an emergency boat.
Yeah.
I was out there also. This is a main heating boiler. Some of the boilers are already past the expected 30-year life cycle. Both of the two boilers at this school are actually 42 years old. They're 1973 boilers, so that's an example of, a boiler that is past its life expectancy, and I'm sure that the water's holding on in there for now. This is another example of a main heating boiler. This one is right at or close to the end of its life cycle. And then here's an example of one. I did a close-up picture of the tag so you can see that this boiler, particular boiler, was built in 1990, so it has roughly about 5 years left on its expected life cycle. So we have that variance within the district between beyond and right at and approaching. And that's a pretty significant cost at every single school. There's two boilers. So
I didn't ask you this before, and I don't mean to put you on the spot. Is that the newest boiler in the district?
Close to it. 1990. Actually, I think there's a couple that are newer.
Okay.
But it's pretty close. There's only a few that are newer than that one.
Right.
I just have a real quick question. For the boilers, why is it that one of or two of them have lasted almost like 45 years, but those ones haven't made the cut? Like
repairs.
Oh, what's that?
You mean to replace them?
They keep them going.
Well, we constantly repair them and test them as needed every year. There's boiler inspections, but as it gets older, it's less efficient. It becomes older and older, and it can fail. So,
well, I mean, is there something different? Is there something different between the newer boilers and the older ones?
They always make engineering improvements to boilers. They become more efficient. They do design changes to them, just like a vehicle.
But they don't last as long.
I don't know the exact life expectancy of a brand new boiler now.
The ones that you saw that looked newer are still functioning. We just wanted to show you the age of each of them. So is it possible that we roll the dice on one that's meeting its life expectancy this year or next for another 10? if we have to, we'll continue to repair until such time as it's...
Or at least have enough money to potentially...
Exactly.
Okay. This is an example of a rooftop AC unit that will need to be replaced in the future. We have a lot of aging AC units located throughout the district. This was a 2014 rooftop AC unit being replaced at Marine City Middle School. Due to necessity, the units had actually completely failed and were no longer working. We were forced to replace these in short time frame without planning. These three units were changed out last year, and just to give you an example, those three units, the cost of changing them out was about $300,000. And there, like I said, there's many of these units, aging units, throughout the district. This is an example of an outdated control system. This system is so old it's actually operating in a DOS-based program. Some people may not even, some of the younger people may not even know what that is, but I think most of us here do, to give you an idea how old this is. This controller is very expensive to have serviced due to it being difficult to troubleshoot and program. There's really only a few guys left in the state that are working on these control pack units right now. Unfortunately, we had to have one of them out here last winter working on it, and I can tell you that it's very difficult to work on the system. Some buildings have as many as three different control systems in them, which is not easy to work with, to say the least.
Kurt, how many of those do we have?
Those old control pack systems? At least four different buildings right now still have the old control pack system in them. Okay. The two high schools, ECEC and Eddy. And then there's a mixture of Train and Bass at the secondary building. So that's why I said there's three different control systems in both the high schools right now. And we'd certainly like to have one, you know, operating system that's controlling the whole building that works together in conjunction. This is an example of one of the newer modern control systems. And it has a Windows-based operating system. It's a lot more user-friendly. And this newer system actually has improved capabilities and is accessible by the operations department 24 hours a day. For an example, I got a call two Sundays ago that the church was in Marine City Middle School, and they said the air conditioning wasn't on. They called me, I got online remotely and did an override and got it running for them until I could go there on Monday and troubleshoot it. So that's very beneficial to have those types of controls and access to the district. This corroded electrical system is for a pool. The system is very old and experiencing accelerated rusting from the pool chemicals and the lack of proper ventilation. We've learned over time in natatoriums and pool environments, you need to have some serious dehumidification and ventilation to prevent premature deterioration of your facility and the equipment. This is an example of what happens when you don't have that. This is another picture of a sump pump down in that same mechanical room that's corroding. This is some corroded electrical systems for the pool. It's an outdated switch type controls. And I wanted to show you for an example of what you would get or see when this equipment was replaced with something brand new. And that's what this picture is. This is an example we would have when older equipment is replaced. Due to an insurance claim, we received new mechanical equipment that included this energy efficient variable frequency drive and all new motors and pumps. This was done because of the entire mechanical room at the Marine City High School got flooded during a storm, and it wiped out all of the equipment in the whole mechanical room. So under an insurance claim, we were able to replace all that old outdated rusted equipment that I showed you in the previous slides with this insurance claim. And this is all the new equipment that you would see in there. It's got stainless boxes and PVC and more corrosive resistant equipment. It's got the variable frequency drives that save you energy when it starts up the motor slower, controls flow. There's a lot of advantages to all this new equipment which is making our pool more efficient down there and saving us money on energy. And there's actually a return on investment in the future when you do these types of projects, so it's extremely beneficial.
Unfortunately, excuse me, the pool heater was not flooded.
Yeah.
And so that was not part of the insurance claim.
Unfortunately, so that heater is above ground level where all the equipment was in the below ground level.
Question in regards to that. We've got all this new equipment sitting down there, but we put it in the same room that was causing the issue in the first place. Are we able to do any kind of update to that room for dehumidification with that new equipment in there, or has it just been replaced?
All the equipment that was replaced, part of the equipment that was replaced is new modulating valves, and that's what is supposed to stop the pool room from flooding when we lose power. So the fact of the flooding that completely destroyed that mechanical room, that failure point has been replaced. However, we still need to upgrade the dehumidification and the ventilation for the area, all of the area, to prevent accelerated corroding. But the good news is a lot of that equipment is more corrosion resistant too, but so we still have some work to do.
That would be the same at both buildings then, I would take it.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. As far as the dehumidification and ventilation, needed at both buildings, yes. This is a picture of some original bathroom showers. This equipment does not work properly, and it's also very difficult to get the correct parts and do repairs on. I believe it's original equipment. In my opinion, it's in very bad need of replacement. ADA accommodations need renovations. This is located in a pool locker room.
Is that the code?
It was when it was built, but it wouldn't now.
Exactly.
Yeah. Bathroom partitions are rusting. And just so you know, these would be replaced with modern composite materials that do not rust at all. There's some examples of them in a few bathrooms in the district, but it's been my experience and my preference to replace them with the composite material because I really like it. It's very durable. It doesn't rust. It's not too bad for cleaning and stuff like that, so that would be my preference. Another example, just so you don't think it was just one bathroom. An additional example. Broken floor tile that needs to be replaced. This is an example of what can be found in many areas throughout the district. Rusting door frame and broken floor tile. Some doors at almost every building are showing deterioration and rusting. These cause trip hazards and also let in cold air during the winter. So, you know, an upgrade to that would save energy. Excuse me, it would remove the hazard, and of course it would be much more aesthetically pleasing than some rotting doors that we have.
Also, another reason to replace those doors is you can see from the frost heaves and things like that, they won't shut. So as someone leaves, if they don't push them shut, then we talk about the safety and security. It might be locked, but it's not shut, so therefore it's not locked.
Rusting door frame and threshold, just so we get a better idea of the scope. This is actually an overhead door in the custodial area, so it's not just walk doors or entry doors. We have overhead doors and access doors and mechanical room and stuff that people don't see every day but still needs to be addressed when they become that deteriorated. A rusting door frame, this was damaged, and at some point it was replaced with a clasp type lock. So we would certainly like to get a new door frame in that location. District-wide roof replacements. Large areas are past the roughly 15-year life cycle of a flat roof in Michigan. Some companies claim longer, some try to stick around the 15 years, but in my experience, with hundreds of thousands of square feet of roof, about 15 years is what I've seen that you can expect out of a life cycle of a flat roof in Michigan, and this is one that we've been patching on a consistent basis. Develops leaks, then we go out there and patch it, and it's in need of replacement. This is a little bit higher up picture of a EPDM rubber type membrane roofing. These also start to dry rot and shrink and crack and cause leaks on the edges and stuff too. So the life cycle on these roofs is a little bit shorter than you would expect on your house shingles, but they don't last very much longer than that either. The edge flashing started to come apart from high winds during a storm. A little bit difficult to see, but on that top roof line edge right there, about a third of the way over from the left, you could see a little bit of difference in that edge flashing that comes along. I was here last spring during a storm when the high winds ripped that flashing up and it started to peel the roof back on there. Unfortunately, we have some very brave individuals that work for TriStar Roofing that came out within an hour and met me out at the building and tied off literally with ropes and went up there and got that material back down and fastened that edging back in place to stop the whole roof from blowing off and storms and rain from getting into the gymnasium. So that company has been very good to work with for our district, and they saved us a lot of trouble. But I wanted to show you this example. That's pretty high up. It's got to be probably 35, 40 feet up off the ground, and they were up there in high winds fastening that back down for us. So, but that area needs some work up there on that roof. District-wide roof replacements. Most roof most modern roof replacements are done using a poly-type membrane and don't usually require this type of stone covering anymore. I'm not saying that they don't ever use this, because I'm sure it is still used by some people and some examples, but in my experience, most of the time we're transitioning to this poly-type membrane that we put over it that doesn't require the stone covering. And it's white, and it reflects the sunlight and lowers your cooling costs in the summertime. So there's some other advantages and cost returns to fixing and using some of the modern materials also. Collapsing storm drain from frost and erosion. There's a large number of collapsing storm drains throughout the district. This is one example right here. And to give you a little idea what happens is you get these frost cycles, especially the last two winters. I'm being told we had over 60 inches of frost in most areas last year, and the normal frost line in the state for construction is 42 inches. So we far exceeded that the last couple of years. And sometimes from that frost heaving, what you get is a concrete will rise or sink at different times of the year and crack on you. Once a crack takes place like that, the water starts infiltrating through that crack and causes erosion underneath. Once it starts eroding underneath, you start to get a failure of that storm drain itself. There's some blocks or bricks around the inside of that manhole as it goes down there, and when the water's coming in through the sides from erosion instead of through the top, through that cover, the whole drain collapses underneath. So then you have to tear the whole thing apart and rebuild it from underneath. So it's pretty significant cost, and there's quite a few of these located throughout the district. We've started to repair them already. There's a number of schools that had some last year that were repaired, and I'm doing a few this year. If you see a brand new white cement square around the storm drain, that's what it was, and that's what we did. So there'll be a few more repaired this year, but we certainly don't have the money to keep up with all of them that are needed right now.
I think the answer is obvious, but like this section of water main, we own those storm drains.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. We own just about everything on our property. We own right out to the easement in the street. This is another example of a collapsing storm drain. This one is located in the middle of a parking lot. That thing is probably sunk about 10 to 12 inches already from its original height in relationship to the parking lot. It's not completely failed yet, so that's one I'm going to have to wait on. But it's another example of cost that's coming. Cement curb on the edge of a bus loop. Many of the cement blocks are crumbling from years of salt and frost cycles. You can see all the seams between the blocks in the background are just deteriorating. I mean, at this school, for example, to replace all the concrete out front that's deteriorating, you're certainly into the tens of thousands of dollars. As just one place at one site. A cement curb on the edge of a parking lot. This is an additional example from different buildings. Again, I didn't want anybody to think it's isolated, because it's not. It's pretty much at every school. Again, this is another different school. Playground surface needing replacement. The blacktop area was patched, last year, but it continues to crumble apart and heave up. Once the water starts infiltrating in there and you get your frost cycles again, even if you patch it, it doesn't stop it from crumbling and coming apart more every year. That really needs to be completely torn out. We would need to do a subsoil investigation, find out what's under there, rebuild the grade underneath, probably taking out certain materials, bringing in sand, building a suitable base, and then rebuilding a new parking lot on top, all pretty expensive, but that's what needs to be done to truly correct that problem. Cement curb on the edge of the parking lot. This dark line that you see in here is a rebar. That's the only thing that's left of that curb. It's completely gone. There's just a metal bar going through where that used to be in the center of a curb. Basketball rim foundation block. The recent frost cycles lifted this block up that holds the basketball rim level and also cracked on the surrounding block. Again, different school. You can tell this one doesn't have the cement around it, but it's got a cement foundation on the pole underneath because of the frost that's heaved and changed its angle pretty severely. This is an example of the deteriorating mortar caused by the lack of proper dehumidification and ventilation in that pool natatorium. You can see that the mortar between the blocks and the boards up top have all completely deteriorated. And if you look at that school, that's the only area that looks like that. You look at this, the surrounding walls that aren't around the pool, and they don't look like that.
So this is external damage showing. Correct. Externally.
Yeah, that's happening internally. That's the chlorine and lack of dehumidification making its way all the way out through the mortar and the panels in the building and rotting it. These are some lockers that I thought were in good shape. I like to show some good things too. These are were recently replaced and very nice looking lockers. These are some that are, in my opinion, in need of replacement. When you open them up, they're rusty and stuff and they don't quite work right, and it sure would be nice to have some of those other ones, nice ones. Carpet being replaced this year. I showed this example because it was so bad that I had truly had to be replaced this year, so it is getting replaced. But there's deteriorating carpet throughout the district that's approaching this point where it's getting this bad. So, but I wanted to show this example, but also assure you, carpet is actually getting replaced this week. So the kids won't have to be using that room on that carpet.
And that's worse than what that
picture was. How is the roof above this carpet that you're replacing?
That's fine. Yeah, there was no leak.
This roof isn't leaking?
Nope.
Okay.
That right there is just from many years of wear and deterioration. There's three classrooms in a row that are getting replaced that are all exactly like that, and it's just because of the age of the carpet.
Mrs. Murphy, you were saying?
I said it looks worse in person than it does in that picture,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Is that at Marine City High School?
That's at Marine City High
that
School.
That is. Yeah. 305, 307, and 308 at Marine City High School.
And that addition, that I think that carpet was probably original, and that addition was put on, and I don't want to tell you.
Okay.
It's been many years.
Well, it's getting replaced this week, so.
Good.
Carpet's
good.
Already on site, actually. This is another example of some carpet needs to be replaced. This is located in a main office of an elementary school. You can see that it's been stretched out and wrinkled by the use of a chair with wheels. I also informed them that we're going to make sure we put down some of those plastic wheel protectors from the chairs when I do get this carpet replaced, but that's why it is like that. If you see in the bottom left-hand corner, you see some delamination and some peeling of that desk right there. This is the same desk right here at the same school. It's actually the secretary's main desk right in the main office, and it needs to be replaced. It's delaminating, deteriorating, and it's all worn out, the mechanical parts and everything. This is another corner of that same desk. So, you know, there's deteriorated carpet, there's a main desk that's coming apart that needs to be replaced. I mean, we really need to get a new desk in there. And backup generator systems. This is, in my opinion, this is the only significant backup generator system in the district. This one services the mainframe system right outside of this building here. There's a couple other real tiny generators that we use just for emergency lighting or emergency running a sump pump. But they're real small, like, you know, ones like you see at for your house. This is the only one that's of significant size. This is an 80 kW generator. Like I said, that backs up the technology room. And due to the frequent loss of power and the increased reliance on electrical devices, the need for backup generators is becoming increasingly important. Just since I've been here, there's been many power outages and caused a lot of difficult situations and very close to lost time and lost school days. So certainly high on my wish list would be some backup generators for the school buildings. And I'm gonna open it up for any additional questions that you might have.
I appreciate all the work that you've done and all the pictures.
No problem. Okay, and for the transition, this is an old rusty PA system, but since we're transitioning to technology, I thought it'd be appropriate picture to put on here.
In the infrastructure piece that we're seeing from our managers here, all these issues would be addressed pretty much, excluding feasibly the furnace that, you know, isn't past its due date or anything like that. We would be addressing those issues in this.
Certainly, yes. Yeah. Okay.
Through your report, you showed a lot of outdated equipment and infrastructure that we've maintained well beyond its useful life. Are any of those things, if we chose to continue status quo and try to maintain these systems for useful life, would we be able to do that? And would the costs associated with that remain flat like they are, or are we in risk of things starting to deteriorate more rapidly than because of where they are in their life cycle?
As they get further into their life cycle, your chance of failure certainly increases. And if you have multiple increases, it becomes very difficult to provide the funding. I mean, so it's a problem.
Thank you.
I'd like to address the idea. They have the maintenance staff, along with previous directors of operations, previous maintenance folks, custodians. They've just done outstanding work to keep what we have functioning and working. You could see that some of them, some of the equipment, is not only beyond usable life. We can't get replacement parts anymore for some of that stuff. And so the question might come up. If we were to replace and if we were to get back up to date and get back on schedule, how are you going to prevent this from occurring again? And I think it's fair to say that there, as pieces of equipment, as Kirk has talked about, are more efficient, would use less utility, would require less emergency expenditures for emergency maintenance, then you could use the money that in the savings that you would get on an annual basis to set aside for proactive regular maintenance going on into the future. Something that currently, unfortunately, the district is too far behind on right now to do that in a method that I think you could set aside $100,000 a year. It wouldn't do the trick.
I think something that may be wise to do as well as a board is to set up like a line item in our budget, like to set aside every year money to.
Yeah, as you become more efficient, you become more capable of creating a sustainable plan, mm-hmm. is what we could call it in facilities, where if you know a boiler needs to be replaced every year, 30 years, you get yourself on a plan where you're replacing one every year for 30 years, and you develop what we call a sustainable model.
But I guess this should be where we do the pitch where all the board members go and look at.
Absolutely.
I think Alan went.
No, not yet.
I'm the only one. I think we all need to go see this.
Yeah, certainly the invitation's there. Any one of you are more than welcome to contact me and make arrangements, and I'll meet you, and we can tour the facilities and look at as many of these items or as many schools as you'd wish to visit.
And Treasurer Murphy, you brought up a really good point as well to me individually, that if and when the board decides that they would like to go forward with a plan, that we have not only these still pictures, but we have some video available for folks to get onto the website to take a look at and take a virtual tour. Or we will set up tours of buildings for the community and the public throughout the course of the next few months in anticipation of a potential ballot, so that folks can actually visually get in themselves. We'll do all of that.
I think that's a wonderful idea, because myself, I had no idea. I went into rooms I didn't even know existed. Mm-hmm. I was blown away.
Right.
Okay. Next is assessment of district technology needs. Director of Technology, Craig Hadley.
Good evening, everybody, members of the board. Thank you for allowing me to provide a brief technology update to you this evening. First thing I want to do is talk a little bit about our department, just another brief overview and a review of some of the things that we do to make sure that we accomplish our goal of limiting equipment downtime. I want to talk a little bit about the state of the district, some of the updates over the last year, 2014-15 school year, that we've been doing. Specifically, I want to talk about three items: our infrastructure, our devices, and then a little bit about safety and security from the technology side. And then finally, I want to end with, where are we today, what are we looking at tomorrow, and what are we looking at in the future? So let's start off by, who are we? We've had some changes in the department this last year. We have had one full-time network administrator move on to another position. But what that's done is that allowed us to not only save the district some money, but restructure some of the personnel within our department to provide more service to our staff and to our students. So this year we welcome Austin Mancaro as our new part-time network administrator, and we also welcome Tiffany Jarski as our new part-time desktop technician. Again, our ultimate goal as a department is to limit our equipment downtime. So how do we do that? We've talked about this before, but one of the things that we need to do as a department and as a district is we need to maintain our consistency. So how do we do that? District computers. All of our district computers are configured with the same software, the same operating system, the same updates. They all have the same browsers. We provide Internet Explorer, Google Chrome, and Mozilla Firefox for them. In today's world, it seems like some websites like some browsers better than others, so we make sure we provide that. What's important, whether you're a substitute or a guest teacher, or you're a teacher moving to another classroom, whatever computer you sit at in our district, we are consistent. You can log in and do the job that you need to do to educate your kids. The other thing we provide consistency in is our support. Centralized help desk system. It's an online ticketing system. We have a help desk number that teachers can call to get help. We have the ability to remote into any computer in our district, kind of provide faster response time, and again, back to our consistency. And with some of that, we've added some energy management features and components to our equipment, which is a good thing. Our computers have software on them where if they were to be left on at night, let's say, or our projectors in our classrooms were to be left on at night, they will shut down at different times during the evening just to make sure that they don't stay on all night long. We know that projector bulbs are expensive, so our projectors, I know, as you know, may well be aware, our projectors turn off at 5 p.m. and 11 p.m. in the evening. Our computers actually turn off at 7:30, 8 o'clock, and 9 o'clock at night just to make sure that they're shut down for the night. But again, all this goes into providing a goal of consistency and limiting equipment downtime. So just a few things by the numbers. This past year, 2014-15, we closed over 2,600 help desk tickets this year as a department. As a district, we own and support over 3,100 computers, laptops, tablet-style devices, iPads, and what we call total devices on the network. Anything that the network would recognize as a piece of equipment on the network, we have over 5,000 devices. And of course, Added to that is BYOD, something we promote within the buildings, bring your own device. Staff, students, bring in their own devices to be able to use on our network. Real quick, throughout the district, we have about 110 network switches, over 300 access points, 486 phones, 16 phone switches, two voicemail servers, 126 security cameras. We provide support for over 5,000 network user accounts. I like this one. 142 miles of network cabling. And of course, BYOD, something we've seen increase year after year after year. Currently, as of last year, we're seeing approximately 900 bring your own device, individual devices in our district every single day in session. So let's talk a little bit about the state of the district. We're going to begin with those three items we talked about, infrastructure, devices, and safety and security. A little bit of infrastructure, and of course, I mentioned this before, it's our switches, our wireless network, phones, voicemail system, and internet. I'd be lying if I didn't say it was a rough year for the technology department in this area. What we've experienced this year is just numerous power outages beyond our control, beyond the district's control. But what that does is, when our equipment, when power goes out in a building or power goes out in an area of the district, our equipment has been shutting off without our ability to control a proper shutdown. And as many of you know, electronics and that type of shutdown just doesn't mix. So it's caused us all kinds of headaches. We have had to replace components in our switches and components in our equipment, not necessarily in the entire pieces of equipment, but it's caused us a lot of pain and suffering in the configuration and so forth. One of the issues is our failing UPSs. One of the things that need to be replaced and something we'll need to address is an uninterruptible power supply or a battery backup unit. What that does is provide temporary power that would give us the ability to address the proper shutdown procedures in a piece of equipment. So one of the things that's happening in these power outages is our UPSs have been failing over the last year and not allowing us to do that. And again, I mentioned the equipment does a hard shutdown. And without going into the technical details, it just does not like to do that. The other thing that we've been seeing this year is excessive heat in our head-end rooms. So every single one of our rooms where our infrastructure equipment is housed in each building has its own individual air conditioner, its own rooftop unit. So what we've seen this year is a lot of failings in our rooftop air conditioning units. And we've had instances this year where our equipment, when it gets overheated, will shut down. The ports on the equipment will turn off, which causes headaches across the entire district because all the equipment throughout the district likes to communicate with each other, and if one is down, it creates havoc and a whole lot of issues with every other piece of equipment in the district. So excessive heat has been causing a problem in our district. And you know, we did a study, a lot of our network switches are running about 20, 25 degrees higher than normal, and higher what is recommended by the manufacturer. And again, I talked about the replacement of components to damaged equipment due to a couple of these issues, the power issues, the heating issues. This is just a quick picture of a UPS. You know, the red light basically means there is no limited backup power for whatever device is plugged into it. Again, on average, we get about 30 minutes, but many of these UPSs are failing and being repaired. Again, I don't know if you can see this picture real well, but this is a picture of the air conditioning in one of our head-end rooms. Rooftop unit comes down to the head-end room and provides cooling and environmental controls for the room. Kind of sum up a little bit what we've talked about. Protecting our infrastructure should be our first priority. Okay? Behind the scenes, the network switches, how the buildings are connected, our wireless, et cetera, is our first priority. Right now, our equipment's still operational, okay? But the items, again, that need specifically, that need to be addressed, power, which directly relates to our network reliability and our network integrity, okay? Our UPSs, our battery backups, again, limited time for power, our failing air conditioning units. You know, and one thing we really would like to look at is generators for our head-end rooms in each building, okay? UPSs provide that 30-minute window for us to get over and maybe shut down a piece of equipment properly. But better yet, and what should be happening, is maybe we provide ongoing power for our equipment beyond what our UPSs can do to keep things like our phone system up and running, okay? So we don't have to worry about that. In an event that the phones need to work, instead of 30 minutes, generators will provide an ongoing power source so that we can keep that equipment running in the district. And generators also provide for air conditioning, so we don't have, you know, to address the overheating issue in our head entrance. Finally, one of the items I put on here that need to be addressed is our network cabling speed. You've heard Paul Twigg from Bart Mallow talk about this, so I didn't put too much of a picture in here for you guys. But right now, we have some access points, which directly affects our BYOD program. We have access points running at 1/10 of their capability. So one of the things that need to be addressed is looking at our network cabling. One of the most important things I want you to be aware of is end-of-life equipment, okay? So most of our infrastructure was installed using the 2009 bond funds. But at some point, they're going to reach what they call end-of-life, the point at which the vendor will no longer support that equipment. We will not get software updates, we will not be able to get parts for that equipment. And so when you had a catastrophic failure or a major piece of equipment fails, you have to replace the entire system. Okay. Beginning in the 2018-19 school year, two major systems of our infrastructure are going to be at end of life. One is all of our network switches, and the second is our wireless network controller that controls the entire wireless network system in the district, and all of its equipment, all of the access points will be at end of life. Devices, item number two. So we talk about classroom smart suites. Which includes a computer, a desk, a printer, a phone, a document camera, a smart board, a sound system, and again, all those were purchased with the 2009 bond funds. I've said this before, and just another reminder, as far as our devices go, we own and support over 3,100 computers, laptops, tablet-style devices, iPads, and plus, bring your own device. What's been nice this year in the 2014-15 school year is we've been able to add devices to our classrooms using grants, donations, our PTOs have been great. So we've still seen a small influx of equipment that's been able to be utilized in the classroom. One thing that we did this year for our classroom computers is we added computer memory, trying to extend the life of our classroom computers. And that's been we've received positive feedback, and that's been a positive thing that we did over last summer. Our smart boards are still operational, our warranties are still good through 2019, and they're still relevant to today. But items that need to be addressed. Something you need to be aware of is all district computers are now out of warranty as the end of 2014-15 school year. In 2015-16, classroom computers will be 6 years old, and they are nearing their end of usable life. Safety and security. I've heard a lot about this recently, so I wanted to update you a little bit on safety and security, specifically security cameras. Something that, you know, doesn't necessarily get to the forefront, but we still support behind the scenes and is a very vital part of how we operate our district. So we installed our security camera system during the 2005-2006 school year. It really, at the time, it was a very robust system, very reliable system. All of our building administrators currently have access to the cameras in their building using software to review what's going on and to see what's happening in the buildings. We are required by law to save video for 30 days from every camera that we have installed. Right now, the software and the cameras run on 5 network servers. But these servers and software are now 10 years old and are no longer supported. Currently, the system is maxed out. There's no room for expansion on the servers. And what we found over the last year is the newest and the replacement cameras that we've had to purchase and install, we've had to configure those cameras to their lowest quality in order to work with this outdated system that we have. Safety and security cameras, items that need to be addressed. Our current cameras do not provide the picture quality consistent with today's standard. We cannot add additional cameras to the existing system, as I alluded to previously. The server and software will need to be replaced to accommodate additional cameras. If we want to add more to the system, we need to replace the servers and the software and give it the ability to operate newer high-resolution cameras and provide the required storage needed by law. Today, tomorrow, and in the future, last year when I did this presentation, I kind of provided the same slides with the same type of where are we heading? What are we doing? What are we doing today? It's important to know, and as I've shared with you, equipment is aging and warranties have expired in our equipment. What we have now is still relevant, but protecting our district infrastructure is our first priority. But also there's important items that need to be addressed moving forward. Tomorrow, here's what's important. Beware of end-of-life equipment. You heard me explain that earlier. End-of-life is zero support from vendors, zero parts. That is a total replacement of equipment that fails. That's important. But again, we're still able to infuse some new technology, grants, donations, fundraisers, as I mentioned, PTOs, it's been great. We continue as a district to encourage BYOD, bring your own device. A few years ago, I remember just a couple hundred devices, and now, as I mentioned, up to 900 per day additional devices using our internet and using our network, which is great to see. We're still consolidating users in the cloud. We are still working with RESA, with countywide software, our student management, our finance, our internet filtering. I mentioned this before, migrated our district firewall over to RESA and saved ourselves approximately $30,000. We are still centralizing our ordering and continuing to use statewide and county bids, which does save us a considerable amount of money on our technology equipment. One thing we did is we moved our email to the cloud. It's called Office 365. And every staff member and student has access to Google Docs, online file sharing, etc. Future, technology changes rapidly, don't we all know? Okay? Here's important to know. Substantial amount of money will be required to replace aging and end-of-life equipment. We know the general fund can't sustain such a replacement effort, but we don't want to wait until the district-wide, until a district-wide failure. So what's our goal? It's important that we continue to protect the community's investment while providing the best possible experience for our students. Finally, what I tell my staff all the time, we tend to be the complaint department. We do love what we do. We do love helping everybody. Put a little world together. This is what we do as a technology department for this district does make a difference in the lives of staff and students. Sometimes it's behind the scenes and you don't see what's going on every day, but what we do makes a difference and we do love what we do. Thank you for your time. I will be back to answer some questions or whatever questions you have. Have a good night.
You saw many of the same themes in technology because technology is a very vital part of our infrastructure, whether it be plumbing or controls or electricity. Technology is the same thing. It's equipment that unfortunately is coming to the end of useful life, can no longer be supported by the manufacturers, and another department within this district that's doing yeoman's work to keep things working on behalf of staff and students. Can't thank them enough for all their hard work. We will have Craig for all future meetings, but it was really important tonight to make that connection to the technology infrastructure as well as the building infrastructure, so I appreciate his effort to put together that video and your time to sit through that. The last piece of our facility presentation tonight, Ralph Schlosser with Barton Mallow, just wants to kind of give you a little bit of an update, which will be much quicker than the last two presentations for you. But again, we're educating tonight, not just you folks, but the community in making the case and trying to help folks understand where we are. Ralph?
Well, good evening. Boy, Craig's going to be a tough act to follow. You did a great job. As Dr. Skalka mentioned, big question is where are we right now? Back in June, I gave you kind of a brief overview of the analysis that our team came up with on the buildings and the summary aspect of that based on the focus groups, based on building systems, based on different scenarios of building usage and things like that. At that time, you all got this book. As Dr. Skelka mentioned, your homework assignment was to review this in detail and come back with some feedback for us, which, as he mentioned, you guys did a great job. I would, if I was a teacher, I'd give you an A. The input you provided is really helpful to us in helping you analyze the data. What we've done is taken the input from the review that you've done and taken those, and you've identified the key items from the board standpoint, infrastructure in the buildings, the technology that Craig just defined very eloquently, safety and security in the buildings, which takes a wide variety of building entrance, the safety of the physical site environments, alarm systems, PA systems, things like that, the site, the paving, as well as the site and security issues. Kirk looked at some of the site issues, the sewers, the curbs, the sidewalks, and things like that that need addressing. Programming issues, collaborative learning spaces, which is a really a key learning approach that's very beneficial for students in the way kids learn these days. I say students, I shouldn't say kids. I was reprimanded on that earlier at a different presentation. The consolidated school program was a desire for the district. The elementary school closure, we looked at that as an option. So those are kind of the key items in general. What we've done is taken the list that you had before. They had a priority one, priority two, and priority three. We've synthesized that into priority one and priority two. So it's either, you know, a critical need and a not so critical need, if you want to say it that way. Looking at the priority one items, at the building, the HVAC systems, the rooftop units, classroom univentilator systems, building control systems that Kirk talked about, the building envelope, just the physical elements that enclose the building, the roofing, the flooring, the exterior walls and doors, things like that, the plumbing system of the building, which includes the pools. Kirk talked about the dehumidification issue, especially in Marine City. That is addressed in the budget costs that are in the book. Electrical systems, technology, Craig talked about that extensively. Paul Twig, he mentioned, has worked with Craig extensively on defining the technology needs and what's required in each of the buildings. Safety and security, you know, security cameras, the PA systems, the security at the exterior doors, a monitored main entry door at each of the buildings during the day. Site issues, the parent pickup, you know, drop-off loop and the bus loops, how they interact, and safety for the parents and students as they are dropped off and picked up at school. Just the parking lot safety issues and the sidewalk safety issues. Site lighting, another safety issue that could use some improvement, as well as efficiency in the lighting itself. The athletic field, the tennis courts, I should mention the tennis courts. In the breakdown on the thing, we got input that the district or high schools now require 8 courts for competition meets. The count for the tennis courts in priority one is now 8. There was also a desire to look at possibility of adding 4 courts at a high school for a district competition or a regional competition. That's there, but it's a priority two item, just for information. Collaborative learning spaces, consolidated preschool program, we talked about those, the elementary school closure at Eddy. Those were the key priority one issues that were identified and that we've incorporated into the study. Priority two items, replacement of some flooring in some different areas, some window replacements, folding wall partitions, a lot of architectural kind of items. Technology, there's some miscellaneous additional AV systems and screens in gyms and cafeterias, clock systems, distance learning, safety and security. What we've done is incorporated a secure building entrance with a video camera system and monitoring system, not creating any kind of building additions to create a sally port entry, things like that. We can provide a secure entrance using a less intense approach to that. Site issues, auxiliary gym expansions. There is thoughts about expanding the current auxiliary gyms to provide a full court space for team practices and used by girls teams as well as boys teams. There is a budget in the priority two at both St. Clair and Marine City High Schools that needs to be looked at a little bit more detail. Both those sites are constrained by existing construction. There's some structural issues involved. It's certainly possible we've done other buildings, but it's something that needs some more analysis on exactly how to accomplish it the best way possible. Remodeling the athletic entrances at the school, so when there's a basketball game or a volleyball game or athletic event, that it prevents a more attractive, easily identifiable entrance to those high school athletic areas. That's a priority two item as well. Replacing furnishings. Right now in the priority one, there's an allowance. It's not saying replace the furniture in the two classrooms or anything like that. It's just a flat allowance per building. Typically in a bond issue, you provide an allowance which gives you flexibility to do anything you want. If you don't say put anything, you can't do anything. So right now there's just a small allowance each building for furnishing. So that's kind of the breakdown in the priority one versus priority two items that's in the current version of the work list. Looking at the breakdown, priority one, priority two, priority one is about $52,150,000. Priority two, $11,960,000. In the priority two, the expansion of the auxiliary gyms and the, what was the other thing I was thinking about? I forgot what it was.
The additional four to make 12 tennis courts?
Oh, that's right. Yeah, exactly. those three items are about in the range of $4.5 million. So those three items are fairly substantial portions of priority two. A lot of the other items are, fairly, minor, I say minor, less costly architectural kind of issues. One thing that Craig touched on, I need to review with Paul Twigg, is the security cameras and the servers for the security cameras to make sure that those are in priority one versus priority two. There's a line item for additional cameras, but I'm not sure if that's additional on top of what is already there or if that's replaced with the existing. So that's one item that we need to review on the technology security side. So that's kind of a brief rundown. There are the updated work lists. I don't know if you've received those copies yet or not, but that is, I think it's a much more straightforward copy that you can look at, and we can still make tweaks on that as you get a chance to review it and provide additional feedback. With that, any questions on the overview of?
I think I understand the list, priority one, priority two, mm-hmm. pulling some things from priority three into one and two, and some
right.
additional things we sprung on you.
Right.
There's also a dollar difference in the master list column of about $3.5 million. Can you speak in general to that at all? I'm comparing what I received today to the list that we got back on the 17th of June.
There's been adds and subtractions. One of the bigger ticket items that was deleted was creation of the sally port entrances and building additions and reorganization of existing administration spaces within buildings to create a sally port entrance. Those have been deleted, and we've gone to the video camera intercom approach. That was one big ticket item that came off.
Yeah, I'm looking at a $3.5 million increase,
right.
if I'm reading right.
As that came off, I think we've put a dollar figure to the auxiliary gyms that weren't there previously, that dollar figure wasn't there previously.
But was that part of the, did that go into the master list or the priority one and two?
It was not included in the list before.
This is the whole thing.
My question was just answered.
Okay. Yeah, I had provided a budget for auxiliary gyms. Right.
Backwards. Right. From right to left. I'm with you now.
He's an engineer.
Well, that's okay. I should have been able to read that.
No,
thanks
no,
for answering
the question.
No,
real good one.
I have a question, though. Yes. And for all the schools you have replaced exactly. furnishings, partial, you have 75,000, you have 25,000, you have, I mean, it's all adding up to a big chunk of money. What are you talking about? What furnishings? I mean, because you even have it for the stadium.
Their furnishings budget? Okay. I think, well, the stadium was probably, what I did is incorporate the same light item across all the buildings. Typically, what I would do at the elementary levels, the allowance, if you will, would be, you know, one number. The middle schools, which is a much larger building, would be a larger number. The high schools, which is a, you know, large facility, would be a higher number. That's they're just arbitrary. You know, if
desk,
there's
tables,
desks,
chairs.
It could be any cafeteria okay. tables, desks, office desks at Kirk. You know, it's shown the picture up in the one administration office. It could be any. It's just an allowance to do anything that needs it. If it's, you know, not a critical item and can be done with, you know, district operational funds, that could come off the list. It's okay. it's just an allowance. It wasn't this desk and this chair kind of thing. It's just,
yeah, because the number just seemed really high for me.
It's probably in the range of maybe 300,000 for the district, maybe 400,000. You know, there's a lot of square footage
for tables and chairs.
Yeah.
So the collaborative learning centers would be furniture, would be out of
right.
that as well.
Exactly, okay. Exactly. Yeah.
And again, correct me please so that we have accurate information. The plan that is presented to Treasury, if it didn't include a line item for this, then you couldn't then have purchases for things that aren't in a plan that's presented to Treasury.
Right. Exactly.
So
if it's
it
not,
doesn't mean you have to spend it on right. that, but without that line item, you couldn't
can't.
Spend
right.
it on it.
And it's not that if there's a exactly. budget for $10,000 for Pine River for furniture, if Pine River doesn't need furniture, it doesn't mean you have to spend $10,000. You have to buy a new desk and put them in. It's an allowance that allows you to mm-hmm. do things if they're needed.
Okay.
You know, we're looking at a bond issue that's going to address district needs, you know, for the next 5 to 6 years. And, you know, there's things that are probably going to happen between now and the end of the program that we can't even foresee right now. So it's provide a little bit of flexibility.
In the security, safety and security issue, is there anything in there plugged in for buses?
No.
Just the buildings themselves?
Just the bus, or okay. just the building, yes.
Okay.
Anything, are you referring to like bus cameras?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That would all be through the bus bond. That would be part of as we build the buses and as we put them out for bid. That would be an included specification on that paid out of the bus
so all
bond.
So all the new buses will be?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay, makes sense. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yep. I oh, go ahead.
The question that I had was about, it was something that just jumped out to me as I read this before I came to the mm-hmm. meeting. The folding partitions at
yes.
the, I don't know if it's just at Bell or both Pine River and Bell.
It's the same configuration of both buildings.
What is the purpose of replacing them? Just that they're old and.
If you recall, it's the corner offices. That as you come into the corner of the room, it's got a partition on the middle and then two triangles. On one of the buildings, I think it's Bell River, a couple locations, that partition is really, you know, pretty sad shape. It's kind of leaning to one side. There's also a desire to create a separate door entry into the two separate classrooms versus having just that open, you know, corner that served both areas. So we hadn't really defined how it would be done, but it was a desire at Bell River specifically to take a look at that issue.
Okay.
Again, I want to thank the board for their hard work. This is an iterative process. iterative by means we keep going back and we give more updates and more feedback, and they get new figures to us until a point where we feel comfortable that we have a proposal that everyone is comfortable with. So with that in mind, I apologize that you received the documentation today. We received it today, but it's part of the iterative process. You have it now for your next round, and then we are going to be meeting next week again to get your feedback, and then it is our desire to, and we've talked with you about this, but we want to get it out on the website and to the newspapers to have a special meeting on Monday, August 10th, for the sole purpose to take the next round of facts and figures and project numbers, so that hopefully at your August meeting you can make a decision as to whether or not to pursue a bond, and if so, for how much and for what projects.
And August, just to clarify, August falls in line with the timeline. We're looking backwards to hit a March election.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Absolutely.
I think the law firm will give you a detailed schedule of activities that need to be done. I would say right now, for a March election, probably have to meet with Treasury probably late November timeframe.
Oh,
yeah.
Sweet.
I think we've shared a timeline with you folks on that.
You did.
Yeah.
Now it's just
good. Yep.
Making sure everybody was aware and agreed.
Perfect.
So that we're not running late later.
I just have a couple questions for Dr. Skoka now. I assume we're going to be allowed to get a copy of everything that was presented tonight.
We put at your table the updated new work list with new estimates.
Right.
I will email you Kirk's presentation. I cannot email you Craig's because it's too big as a video file.
Okay.
But if you would like to stop by, I can provide it to you on a flash drive.
Okay, awesome. And then the other thing I think that would be helpful for the board, and I don't know about the community, but for sure the board, would be a list of assets in the school district currently. And is there something like that that may exist somewhere?
It exists for insurance purposes. I don't know if what is on that list of assets is what you are describing.
As in,
so it might be wise that again we get you in, take a look at it, and say, yep, that's exactly what I need, or I'm looking for something else.
Okay, that sounds good.
Okay,
I was just curious, how does the list of assets help the board?
Well, to figure out what exactly needs to be replaced and what doesn't.
That might be the work that Barton Mallow and Kirk have been doing. I don't know that that's necessarily a board level work to look at chairs and pencil sharpeners, but I, because there is opportunity cost with everything that we look to pull.
That's true, but when we're talking about raising taxes, I think it's important to look at all the.
Well, I made it no secret that I was against this at first until I walked into these schools with Kurt. I suggest you do that first. It changed my whole attitude when I seen the skeleton of our buildings.
It's a good point that you're walking the assets.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And you know, Kirk did a fabulous job of explaining to me exactly, you know, this is what this does and this is what that does, and without this we can't do that. And I didn't understand half of it, but I got it. I know that would be your first step instead of looking at it just.
Okay. I'm not saying that things don't need to be replaced. I'm just saying that the way of doing it is what I'm debating.
So. Kirk's knowledge of our district and in the infrastructure is amazing for the short time that you've been with us.
So oh, yeah.
I just commend you on what you know about our district and what you do.
He knows thank you. Every nook and cranny of these buildings.
And thank you to Raul and Daryl for all your time that you put in with us and your continued support. So we'll be back at you again.
I'll get my next over.
Move on to our board action agenda items. Per administration recommendation, the Board of Education approve Rachel Card as the Bell River Elementary Principal per ECSD Administrator's Contract, effective for the two-year period of 2015-16 and 2017-18. Motion is needed.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Kenickbauer.
Support.
Support by Mr. Richley. Comments or questions?
I just want to say that I've heard a lot of good things about Mrs. Card over the years, and she's been an awesome teacher. So I think it should be a great addition to the administrative team.
We're excited.
I agree.
I have a personal experience with that. My son was in her class, and I think this is a great hire for the district.
She brings a lot of experience. We look forward to having you as part of our administrative team. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, same sign. So moved. Congratulations. The Board of Education, last recommended action, the Board of Education extend the current contract by 1 year of Superintendent Stephen C. Skalka through June 30th, 2018.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Skalka. Moved by Mr. Kenickbauer.
Support it.
Support by Mr. Distelrath. Comments, questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Mr. Richley. Last item on our agenda, items for our next regular board meeting, the annual report, and summer school report.
I just want to bring to the board's attention that the annual report is something that occurs at each August board meeting, but the state has waived the mandatory annual report, as it's not known when the M-STEP data, which is the new test, when those cut scores will be official. And it is an intermediate assessment. We don't know what the next assessment is going to be. It was put in place for 1 year to tide us over between MEEP and the final assessment. So there is a very real possibility that you won't see that on your agenda next month.
Okay. With that, we stand adjourned. Thank you.